Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents All Ages Becoming, Intergenerational Practice and the Formation of God's People by Valerie M. Grissom. Narrated by Nan McNamara. Introduction. Practicing Our Becoming. Valerie M. Grissom. Beware of harking back to what you once were when God wants you to be something you have never been. Oswald Chambers. A Story of Becoming. At 8 years old, I discovered a fluttery ping-pang in the mason jar I had hidden away weeks earlier, its lid still full of nail holes. Inside, a brand new yellow and black swallowtail butterfly with spots of orange and dusty blue attempted to flap its new lacy wings, fragile and delicate. Resembling the crinkly skin on a new baby, the new butterfly's accordion-like wings that had been crumpled up in its cocoon worked to unfold. I scurried to open the jar in which I had previously placed the bulgy lime-green caterpillar weeks before. The jar I lost interest in when the caterpillar lethargically ate its way to the top leafy branch, snuggling in for a long nap, disappearing into a leaf-induced coma, and overnight, spinning a chrysalis, transforming from colorful to colorless, lifeless gray. I had given up watching this caterpillar sleep, wondering if it had even been worth collecting. This caterpillar seemed dead, with no life in sight. Now, the cocoon-turned butterfly slowly jumped out, taking wobbly baby steps, trying to flap its folded wings. It was trying to teach itself how to fly. I placed this delicate butterfly on my hand. It tickled me with its new black antenna as it crawled slowly up my arm onto my elbow, then onto my shoulder. By then, my younger siblings had joined me, watching in awe, sharing the wonder of how something that had looked so drab and lifeless before could now look beautiful and new. The transformation enthralled us. What had looked dead now looked alive. Soon, a new problem put a lump in my throat. What began as wonder now transformed into a sense of trepidation. Would this delicate creature survive? Was she really suited for the harsh realities of this world? How could she make her way when she could barely unfold her wings, let alone fly? We decided to train the butterfly. On our front porch steps, we coaxed the beautiful butterfly to fly. Still, it crawled on the ground, unsure of itself. Gradually, its unfolded wings became more comfortable. Newness wore off, and the butterfly flapped its wings with ease, practicing ascent. Still, it did not yet know it was a butterfly. It did not know it could fly. So it dropped ever so lightly to the ground. Each time, we thought it would break its delicate wings. But each time, it got braver and more experimental. Soon, it flew a foot above the ground, then a yard. Then it landed again on my arm, and then on my head. Minutes became hours as we watched this butterfly move from baby steps to pre-flight checks toward aerial prowess. As this new butterfly practiced what it was to become, I had a new lump in my throat, a lump of sadness this time. I realized this butterfly could never remain in a jar or on my porch. It was destined to fly. With each airborne stride, I realized my fat little caterpillar turned cocoon turned butterfly was now to become free, to fly away and become the butterfly it was always meant to be. The butterfly flew to our flowery bush, then to our tree, to the neighbor's flowers, and out of sight. What is the church becoming? As I look toward the future, I see so many similarities between this new butterfly and the unfolding wings of the church, especially in regard to the intergenerational movement forging ahead in our present time. In the past few years, our churches have experienced massive transformation some changes for good, and some warranting concern. In March of 2020, the COVID-19 pandemic reshaped not only how we live, but how we worship. Churches around the world grappled with these questions. What in the church is essential? Can we really have community online? What is being left in the margins when we have online worship? How can we honor and protect our oldest, most vulnerable generations? How do we include our younger generations online? In addition to a worldwide health crisis, we saw the largest global recession since the Depression, supply shortages, and deep racial and political tension. Due to COVID-19, people of all ages suffered from trauma, death, grief, isolation, depression, and so much more. Meanwhile, our church leaders have been scrambling to keep up with these new pandemic-shaped realities. Worship at home, Zoom worship, hybrid worship, worship with masks, COVID resurgences. All the while, we struggle to help all ages and all generations feel seen, heard, and loved. Exhaustion of leaders, parents, families, elders, and children lingers. Even as we continue to crawl our way out of the COVID cocoon and back to church. And reports say burnout in ministry leaders is at an all-time high. In the corporate world, they are calling it the Great Resignation, where people are quitting their jobs in massive numbers. A Barna study reports that 40% of pastors considered quitting full-time ministry as of March 2022. All the while, in the church, leaders are asking, will the people ever come back? Where are all the parents with young children? Even though COVID cases and restrictions are waning, and we have resumed in-person worship, people are still not coming back to church in the way we hoped. Studies released in January of 2023 say that while attendance is returning closer to pre-pandemic numbers in older generations, the percentage of young adults, 18 to 29, who have completely stopped attending church has increased from 30% in 2018 to 43% as of April 2022, a trend already evident before the pandemic. Some generations, especially older ones, ask, "Why are you still talking about the pandemic? It's all but over. Let's get back to living our best life." Younger generations, on the other hand, who have experienced educational upheaval, job loss, parenting crises, and financial stress, are indignant, insistent that we do not overlook the trauma they have experienced and the new realities they face post-pandemic. Meanwhile, in the church, we forge a new path forward, together, with all these tensions, realities, polarities, uncertainties, and generational discord. Did intergenerational go away? During the pandemic, many asked, did intergenerational go away? Surprisingly, we observe intergenerational continuing to thrive in new and exciting ways. Generations coming together to share faith through small groups in the home and on Zoom, FaceTime, evening prayer, outside and in the gym. Invention, creativity, persistence, and innovation have shown us that intergenerational continues to flourish, and churches keep becoming, unfolding those wings, experimenting with new ways forward. And this kind of experimentation and innovation is nothing new when it comes to Christian community. Whenever we seek to be the body of Christ, practices of intergenerationality emerge. To be intergenerational is to live more fully into what it means to be the body of Christ. Thus, intergenerational cannot go away when we continue to practice being the people of God. Becoming through intergenerational Christian practice. In Romans chapter 12, verse 2, we, the people of God, are called to be transformed, Greek for metamorphosis, in a metamorphic-like process of transformation akin to the butterfly. We are God's people, all transforming, practicing in different stages, in the same way the butterfly becomes by experiencing metamorphosis, egg, larva, pupa, and butterfly. we recognize that we are all in the midst of becoming transformed to be more like Christ. The whole metamorphic process is miraculous. How God designed a bumbly caterpillar to transform into something completely new, as beautiful, delicate, and majestic as the butterfly. In the adult stage, the butterfly is called the imago, Latin for image. According to Encyclopedia Britannica, a remarkable process occurs. From caterpillar to adult, most of the caterpillar tissue disintegrates and is used as food, thereby providing energy for the next stage of development, which begins when certain small structures, imaginal discs, in the larva start growing into the adult form. The parallels here to Christian transformation are uncanny. We die to self, Galatians chapter 2, verse 20, and take on a new DNA, the image of God, imago Dei, as we are transformed to be more like Christ. This picture of metamorphic Christian transformation is beautiful and nothing short of the miraculous work of God. Practices or spiritual disciplines, according to Dorothy C. Bass, are shared activities that address fundamental needs of humankind and creation, and that woven together form a way of life. In Liturgy of the Ordinary, Sacred Practices in Everyday Life, Tish Harrison Warren states, God is forming us into a new people, and the place of that formation is in the small moments of today. For Harrison, the smallest of rhythms and patterns or practices in the everyday become sacramental-like moments where God extends grace and forms us to be more like Christ. In the same way, in our ministries and churches, we can choose rhythms and patterns of intergenerational Christian practice that form us to be more like Christ and to become the people of God. Intergenerational Christian practices are intentionally shared rhythms and patterns of participation in Christian community that foster relationships with God among all ages and help us mutually honor God and one another for the sake of becoming more like Christ. God's design for the church, as seen in the pattern of Scripture, was for us to live in intergenerational faith communities in which we practice growing in our faith together. As we participate in intergenerational relationships and spiritual patterns of our God-formed family of faith, we are transformed to be more like Christ. We all become God's people by being God's people. Thus, intergenerational Christian practice is more than a list of ideas, implementations, aspirations, or an ideal to model. Rather, it is a way of life for all generations together to become God's people. Intergenerational Christian practice reflects miraculous metamorphic transformation. As we share in intergenerational rhythms that help us participate in the family of God, we take on the new family DNA of God, Galatians chapter 3, verses 26 through 29. We become who we were created to be in the image of God as part of God's intergenerational community of faith. Intergenerational Christian practices, when repeated, continually put on this new DNA, becoming formational spiritual acts, habits, and patterns that form us while being in Christian community. Unlike caterpillars, which are what scientists call terminal or unable to reproduce, the imago adult butterfly can reproduce. In the same way, when we participate in becoming the body of Christ through intergenerational Christian practices, we become part of a reproducible, ongoing faith transformation, transmitted and reproduced from one generation to the next. In metamorphosis, transformation is a process. We cannot skip a step, but we can have faith that our practice is taking us forward toward God's intended result. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10 states, "We, the church, are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do." New International Version. We are destined to transform into God's beautiful creation, the handiwork of God. All Ages Becoming offers an overview of what we are learning and experiencing in and through intergenerational Christian practice. Section 1, Foundations of Intergenerational Practice. Just as the butterfly in my opening story was unsure who she was, many of us still work to define what intergenerational really is. Here, we invite you to explore theological foundations of intergenerational Christian practice. As with any movement or practice in the church, we must first attend to our theological underpinnings. We cannot become when we do not know what we shall become. With that in mind, Linda E. Stotz, who represents decades of experience in intergenerational Christian practice, describes the beautiful circular pattern of intergenerational blessing. She uniquely lays down an intergenerational foundation that will help both newcomers and longtime practitioners explore the basis and theological foundations for intergenerational practice. Next, Wilson McCoy recovers a deeper why of intergenerational practice, how creational theology based on the Imago Dei, image of God, enlarges our understanding of intergenerational ministry. He explores what it means for us to honor God's image in one another, and in turn, helps us bear God's image to one another in community. In our third chapter, Gareth Crispin challenges listeners to re-examine their theology of the Holy Spirit and how the Spirit's work can lay a fertile ground for a more inclusive intergenerational community. Drawing on the term ludicity, Latin for play, Crispin notes how some churches have successfully created contexts with high levels of participation, informality, freedom, and relational safety among members. Can theological convictions and our experience of God nurture intergenerational Christian practice? This section, as well as future sections, should help you begin thinking intergenerationally and identify many questions you can discuss with others as you personalize and embody the theological foundations of intergenerational practice. Section 2, Reimagining Intergenerational Practice. As a child, I found it difficult to envision a gray cocoon becoming a beautiful butterfly. In the same way, churches often struggle to envision intergenerational services operating in old paradigms and systems. We lack an intergenerational imagination to see what intergenerational ministry could look like in future practice. Section 2 offers 4 intergenerational reimaginations regarding apprenticeship, family discipleship, preaching, and worship, all key areas in need of new intergenerational imagination. These chapters explore both theology and practice, challenging leaders to reimagine how their community might be more intentionally intergenerational. Johanna Myers offers a reimagining of adult roles in intergenerational discipleship, giving new advice for apprenticing faith. Here, Myers holds up Jesus' ministry as an apprenticeship model, in direct contrast to current methods that prioritize knowledge-based discipleship, not knowing about Jesus, but living and experiencing Jesus in an intergenerational community of faith. Rachel Turner then casts a new intergenerational reimagining of family discipleship, in which the church empowers parents to become primary disciplers in the home. Often, in our current church scenarios, church culture elevates everyone but the parents. Rather, she shows us how we in intergenerational community might reimagine a new way that empowers and enables parents of all ages to disciple children of all ages and pass down faith to the next generation. Turner offers advice to intergenerational leaders for implementing intergenerational practices that can cultivate this kind of parental discipleship for all ages. Next, David M. Sinis offers a much-needed new theology for intergenerational preaching that sets aside old presumptions and casts a fresh imagination, allowing for the innovation of intergenerational preaching practices. And finally, Robert Pendergraft, who draws upon the principles of universal design, reimagines worship that is accessible for and engages all ages. He calls us, as intergenerational leaders, to use the intergenerational Christian practice of building ramps instead of stairs. All ages with differing levels of ableness are given ramps that invite and empower them to participate and respond in worship. As you engage with this section, our prayer is that you will be inspired to reimagine these key areas of apprenticeship, discipleship, preaching, and worship. In turn, our hope is that you will be challenged to reimagine other intergenerational theologies and practices unique to your context. Section 3, Implementing Formative Intergenerational Practices. Just as a new butterfly has to practice being a butterfly, the church must practice being intergenerational. But the question here moves past the question of what, and now becomes how. My son's percussion teacher often tells him that he cannot get rid of bad habits, he can only replace them with good habits. Implementing healthy intergenerational Christian practice is key to fostering intergenerational values and helping people live more deeply into what it means to be the people of God. We must also realize that intergenerational Christian practices are part of a transformational process. Practices are just that, practice. A mindset bent on perfection or completion is not one of practice. Thus, each intergenerational Christian practice becomes an experiment constantly open to alteration and revision. As we learn and grow and participate more deeply in our intergenerational Christian practices, we might need to adjust, remove, reimagine, or create. We cannot take ourselves too seriously in this process. We will fail. We will make mistakes. Even in the muddling and mistakes, we are formed. With each step, intergenerational Christian practices teach, advise, enlighten, inspire, and renew us. Karen DeBoer, an experienced teacher and writer regarding intergenerational faith practices, starts by offering a tutorial on the why and how of faith practices, followed by some very practical ways we can incorporate intergenerational faith practices right now and throughout the week in our faith communities and at home. Next, Johanna Myers and Roberta J. Egli of Messy Church explore how intergenerational faith communities, using the model of Jesus, can incorporate intergenerational practices for creating space where faith can grow. Breen Marie Sipes follows with a chapter on intergenerational Christian practices for leaders to incorporate that allow the Spirit to lead, cultivating spiritual formation in both leaders and participants. Finally, my chapter discusses how intergenerational story sharing can become an intergenerational Christian practice that helps faith communities practice being the body of Christ in a deeper, fuller way. Altogether, these intergenerational practices are a sampling of ideas. But even more, they are a tutorial on how to develop and implement the process of intergenerational practices. By thinking through their formative power, we, as the body of Christ, can engage with intergenerational Christian practice in tangible, formative ways. Section 4, Stories of Intergenerational Practice. If you have not figured it out yet, I am a musician, hence my emphasis on practice. Good practice involves experimentation and innovation. Part of musical practice is the art of improvisation, taking the fundamentals and the music and making it your own. Just as the butterfly in the opening story started branching out and trying new things, working toward flying in order to become, we must engage in intergenerational experiments of practice. Section 4 includes stories of four intergenerational leaders who have experimented with intergenerational Christian practice in their own faith communities. First, leadership and life coach Jim Merhot shares how his faith community used reinvention principles to implement change to start a new intergenerational worship gathering. Through the process, Merhot shares principles of reinvention we can apply to our unique contexts. Next, Wes Gallagher shares how he learned, in his role as a children's pastor, the intergenerational Christian practice of creating subcultures, smaller communities within the larger community, where people might experience the taste and see of intergenerational ministry. Many of us intergenerational leaders can identify with Gallagher's plight, where he is not able to make church-wide systemic decisions. Thus, the practice of creating intergenerational subcultures becomes vital for those lacking total authority to make systemic change. Next, Sarah Bentley Allred shares her rubber meets the road story of learning how to plan intergenerational worship, offering many practical insights she learned along the way. Allred offers many ideas for implementing intergenerational practices, tailoring them to your context. Finally, Elizabeth Tamez Mendez, founder and executive director of a global intergenerational organization called NG3, shares how she learned to practice familia by honoring the generational and cultural treasures in her unique Latin American context, an intergenerational Christian practice we can apply to each and every one of our own faith communities. Though these stories have their unique particularities, here we see implementation of intergenerational practice in progress and realize that by sharing in each other's stories of intergenerational practice, we are formed and inspired to experiment with and implement new intergenerational Christian practices. As with all the other sections, we provide questions to help you consider how you might apply their learnings to your context. Section 5, Survey of Current Intergenerational Practices. Although I cannot be sure, the butterfly in my story probably never understood what it was to become until it soared in flight, taking an aerial view of all that had been and what had happened and what was to come. In the last chapter, Holly Catterton Allen provides an aerial view, or survey, of more current intergenerational Christian practice by reviewing doctoral projects, theses, and dissertations focusing on intergenerational ministry from 2010 to 2020. She unpacks the findings from these doctoral projects regarding intergenerational leadership, worship, learning, and other practices. Allen, whose main area of research for two decades has been intergenerational ministry, also shares her own conclusions regarding intergenerational practice. As we all continue to practice intergenerationally, her insights here inspire us to continue practicing, to facilitate new ideas, new innovations, new research, new study, and new experiments as we engage in future intergenerational Christian practice. Become what you receive. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for God's own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of God who called you out of darkness into God's marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 9 through 10, English Standard Version. Often in church liturgy, pastors and priests invite the people of God to Eucharist or communion in thanksgiving using the words of St. Augustine of Hippo, "Behold what you are, become what you receive." As you receive and engage in these stories of transformational becoming through intergenerational Christian practice, I invite you to be reminded that you are what you receive. You are a child of God. You are a gift from God. You are God's people. You are that picture of beautiful, divine, metamorphic transformation when you participate in intergenerational Christian practice. I urge you to behold God's goodness and blessing that surround your intergenerational community and to become what you receive as you receive the blessing of engagement and participation in intergenerational Christian practice. How to use this book. As you engage with this book, remember that intergenerational Christian practice is formational and unique to your context, a process that happens in community. With that in mind, we offer theology in practice sections that help you move from the theoretical to the practical. These questions are designed to help you reflect and reimagine, both individually and in community, to consider how these ideas and stories might shape your future intergenerational practice. I'm a butterfly in the making, in a protected, sheltered state. I know you wish to see me fly. I know it's hard for you to wait. I can't be rushed or hurried. I need the struggle to break free. My wings are not yet fully formed. I'm not ready. Can't you see? I'm a butterfly in the making. The pain and struggle are very real. I wish I could make you understand. I wish you could feel what I feel. Maybe you thought I don't try hard enough. Maybe you thought I wanted to stay. I wish you could see how hard I'm trying to spread my wings and fly one day. Step inside my chrysalis. Take a look inside my world. Then perhaps you'd understand why I'm like a rose, struggling to be unfurled. Gail McMillan, July 16, 2018. Section 1. Foundations of Intergenerational Practice. It's not necessarily the amount of time you spend at practice that counts. It's what you put into the practice. Eric Lindros, professional hockey player. Chapter 1. Circle of Blessing, Foundation and Fundamentals for Intergenerational Ministry. Linda E. Stotts. We are what we repeatedly do. Excellence, then, is not an act, but a habit. Will Durant. I grew up in rural Iowa, where I was surrounded by 8 living grandparents and great-grandparents, all of whom lived within 14 miles of my home. The adults in my small congregation and community called me by name. I knew I was loved and I belonged. It wasn't until I was an instructor in a metropolitan community college that I realized my childhood experience was not the norm. I was surprised to learn that many of my students had few caring adults in their lives, let alone loving, meddling grandparents. Later, as minister for faith formation in a large suburban congregation, and then serving in a similar role at a judicatory and national level, I was dismayed to learn that intergenerational relationships and ministry were the exception rather than the normal practice in our communities of faith. Christian leaders and educators have become so accustomed to age-specific culture, curriculums, and interaction that there is often hesitation and even fear at the idea of bringing all generations together. My hope is that this chapter adds to the listener's desire and confidence in creating a circle of blessing, a community of faith that includes all generations and ages in all stages of faith and life, where intergenerational ministry simply becomes the natural approach in all we plan and do. What is intergenerational ministry? Intergenerational ministry nurtures Christ-centered community by bringing together 2 or more generations in planned and purposeful settings where all are mutually invested. Intergenerational ministry is more than a program. It serves as a lens and a foundation for how we see, think, plan, and evaluate ministry. More importantly, the focus is to be truly the body of Christ. The body of Christ in the circle of blessing is complete when the perspectives and unique gifts of all generations are engaged in the ministry and life of a congregation and its community. Luke chapter 15, verses 3 through 7. Intergenerational ministry is purposeful, interactive, and inclusive. Intergenerational ministry values the needs, gifts, and perspectives of each generation, resulting in an entire community of faith, its neighborhood, and its households becoming energized. When people of every age care for one another, share highs and lows, worship, learn, and serve together inside and outside the walls of the church, relationships and ministries across the age span are strengthened, and the presence of the Holy Spirit is undeniably felt. Intergenerational ministry moves away from age-segregated or age-specific ministry, for which there is still a valid time and place. Intergenerational ministry is distinct from multi-age or multi-generational curriculum and ministry, where several ages, grades, or decades of participants are grouped together. For example, Sunday school, youth group, older adult ministry. Instead, intergenerational ministry is a congregation's commitment to crisscross the borders of age and stages of life to create a sustainable, resilient community of faith that breathes life into households and neighborhoods, and to bring hope and healing to the world. Why intergenerational ministry? Intergenerational ministry is not new. A quick internet search reveals more than 80 references to generations in the Bible, both in the Old Testament and throughout the New Testament. Pages of biblical text list the genealogy of families, lifting up stories and connections from generation to generation. Authentic relationships between generations and in the gathered community are embedded in our Christian and Jewish faith traditions and in the rituals and practices of our varied denominations. In Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 6 through 7, parents are encouraged to be the teachers of faith at home and away from home. In Psalm 78, verses 1 through 6, the generations are encouraged to share their personal experiences of God in order to nurture and keep faith alive. In the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, and Luke, Jesus welcomes and blesses children in the midst of a gathering of adults. Matthew chapter 18, verses 2 through 6 and verse 10, chapter 19, verses 13 through 15, Mark chapter 9, verses 36 through 37, chapter 10, verses 13 through 16, Luke chapter 9, verses 47 through 48, chapter 18, verses 15 through 17. The interchange between David and Saul, 1 Samuel chapter 17, verses 31 through 40, as David prepares to fight Goliath, is an example of God equipping the younger generation with the tools and resources needed, even in the most challenging of times. Biblical characters followed God's call to lead and serve at every age, such as Mary, Jeremiah, Timothy, Samuel, Moses, Sarah and Abraham, Simeon, and Hannah. No one was or is too old or too young to be Christ's disciple. The gifts and perspectives of every generation are needed to create and sustain our communities of faith. By bringing all ages together to hear, know, and give witness to God's story, we discover God's story in one another's story. Creating an intentional community of all ages, a circle of blessing, creates opportunity to celebrate God's presence and ongoing activity in every generation. My consistent, persistent rallying cry when working with congregational leaders echoes the words of Peter L. Benson. As a community of faith, we possess a vast untapped potential to gather all the generations around the cross of Christ to create a robust faith that carries individuals through every age, stage, and milestone of life, and to equip them to be active, authentic witnesses to the good news of Jesus Christ, at home and away from home. Living into a vision for becoming a vibrant intergenerational community of faith and the body of Christ includes these practices: weaving together the views, skills, perspectives, and unique gifts of children, youth, young adults, and elders into the practical everyday life and witness of a Christian faith community and its households; nurturing lifelong discipleship, where generations equip one another and their households as centers for practicing the Christian faith; naming and encouraging the gifts seen in one another in order to grow, shape, mentor, and develop leaders; bringing together youth and caring adults in service learning that transforms the relationship, creates shared stories, and fosters a common identity as Christ's disciples; creating an intergenerational system of support that provides an anchor for the congregation and the community; helping households remain resilient and hopeful in times of crisis, such as during the worldwide COVID pandemic, providing opportunities to truly see the other by creating an essential web of care across generational divides and distance. Kara Powell, Jake Mulder, and Brad Griffin in Growing Young state, "Fuel a warm community. Warm is the new cool." Relationships formed on the foundation and fundamentals of intergenerational ministry provide a lab for households to crisscross and connect the borders of age, stage, and experiences that separate us right here and right now in one's own faith community and each person's daily life. In doing so, individuals of every age, especially children, become more confident and capable of embracing diversity in the larger community and world. Thus, the circle of blessing becomes glocal, growing from local to global. Who are the generations? Our news sources are filled with information and opinions about generational characteristics and both the challenges and benefits of working together. Rather than dismissing another generation, relationships across the age spectrum are strengthened when we acknowledge, appreciate, and celebrate each generation's uniqueness and contributions. The key to breaking down stereotypes and building respect is understanding generational markings that shape and form individuals born within a specific time frame. We must recognize that the beliefs, biases, values, stories, worldview, and faith narratives of individuals are shaped and influenced by each generation's time in history and accompanying life experiences. Doug Cook from Cheyenne, Wyoming, and a member of our intergenerational planning team for the Generosity Project, offered this reflection following participation in a mixed-age, multi-generational small group conversation related to stewardship in his congregation. One of the more powerful moments was hearing how a person's life events impacted their faith. I witnessed people sharing stories unique to their age group, that is, the Depression, Great Society initiatives, civil rights movement, Vietnam War, 9/11, Hurricane Katrina, Haiti earthquake, and how those events affected one's priorities and faith journey. Generational researchers and specialists typically refer to 5 or 6 generations in our society. When we include those who are 95 and older, plus the most recently named and youngest generation, then there are 7 generations to acknowledge in our communities and in our congregations. The dates and brief descriptions that follow are not universal, but they act as a grid for interpreting key events and experiences commonly cited for generational cohorts. Note that generational allocations are most specific to people who live in the United States. Certainly, other factors such as race and ethnicity, gender, socioeconomic status, and region also influence these generational characteristics. 1901 to 1926, the GI generation / civic / greatest generation. Impacted by World War I, served in World War II, came of age during the Great Depression. Value responsibility, duty, and honor. Sacrifice self for others. Frugal, loyal to a faith tradition. 1927 to 1945, traditionalist / silent generation. Korean War, Cold War, Industrial Revolution. Value conformity and traditional values. Disciplined, self-sacrificing, conveyors of generational wealth. Appreciate sermons and traditional music. 1946 to 1964, baby boomers. Aftermath of World War II. Assassinations, civil rights, moon landing, Vietnam. Roaring 60s, drugs, yuppies, challenged traditional institutions, risk takers, individualistic, buy now, pay later, first generation to leave hometowns, known to church shop. 1965 to 1980, Gen Xers, AIDS crisis, Challenger disaster, fall of Berlin Wall, Gulf War, 9/11, personal computers, latchkey kids, impacted by divorce, skeptical, collaborators, generation ignored by marketers. Join non-denominational churches. 1981 to 1996, millennials. Digital natives, 9/11, Iraq-Afghanistan wars, Obama election, Sandy Hook. Risk-averse, delay marriage. Gay marriage, social media, cell phones, internet. Prefer teamwork, spiritual, not religious. Religiously non-affiliated. 1997 to 2012, Gen Z. Recession, homeland security, school shootings, cyberbullying, global pandemic. Accept diversity. Connect instantly 24/7. Realistic, private, self-directed. Savers, reliant on technology. Socially conscious, disengaged with religious institutions. 2013 to 2025, Alpha/Touch generation. Global pandemic. A world of iPads, Instagram, apps. Live in a personalized marketing world. Virtual learners. Screen saturated. Reaching age 100 may be the norm. Outer space exploration. Labeled pre-Christian. Another reason to recognize and celebrate seven generations is found in the seventh generation principle. Many Native American nations and indigenous people around the world follow this philosophy. The principle is based on an ancient Iroquois belief that the decisions we make today should result in a sustainable world seven generations into the future. Reverend M. Kalani Souza, a Hawaiian elder, defines seven generations in this manner. Each human being is five generations, if you're lucky. If you're lucky, you experience your grandparents, your parents, your generation, your children's generation, and if you're lucky, your grandchildren's generation. You are five generations walking. The sixth generation is everybody who ever came before you, your ancestry back to the end of time. You should respect that and know it and honor it. The seventh generation, anybody who's ever coming after you. So when we say make the decision with the seven generations in mind, what decision do you make that is not made for all time? So careful, careful as you move through the world. So this should be a lesson for our policymakers and our leadership. No decision that they make is not for all time. Souza uses the words five generations walking. All those who came before you to the beginning of time represent the sixth generation. All those who come after you represent the seventh generation. Souza passionately states, no decision should be made that the impact on the seventh generation is not considered. Similarly, in the church, we too should consider our decisions and the impact we make on the seventh generation. Each choice and each relationship impacts all generations. Tips: where and how to begin. Where do ministry leaders begin when incorporating an intergenerational approach into their ministry? It does not take a program, a line item in a budget, or a committee's approval to begin. The first step begins with you researching and describing your own lineage and family in generational terms. For example, I am the daughter of Letta, the daughter of Lydia, the daughter of Sophie. As of this writing, my mother is 103 years old and represents the GI generation. I am a boomer married to a traditionalist. Our two sons are Gen Xers. I am the adopted grandmother to two millennial young adults in Kenya and great-grandmother to their alpha generation preschoolers. Understanding the generational placement of myself and those around me helps me connect with other generations. The second step toward intergenerational ministry begins by simply naming, claiming, and celebrating the generations already inside the walls of the church and in one's neighborhood. More than a program, intergenerational ministry is a lens, a language, and a way of being that forms the foundation for the unfolding life and witness, disciple forming, and servant leadership of ministry. Often, leaders lament, "Yes, but we don't have any children, teens, or young adults, or fill in the blank, in our midst." That may be true, but intergenerational ministry offers an opportunity to become a vital community partner. Reach out beyond the church's walls into the neighborhood and connect with the nearest school, after-school or preschool program, senior care center, police or fire department. Equip grandparents, aunts, and uncles for meaningful virtual engagement with grandchildren, nieces, and nephews who live at a distance. Be prepared to meet needs you did not know existed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.